Hey dudes, welcome to Splat from the Past, the only 80s themed horror and sci-fi show where things can get totally radical. Now today I will be welcoming, she's a horror host and an actress and a horror shop owner based in Ohio, I believe. Her name is Janet J, but she goes by Janet DK, Janet Decay. And I'm going to have her on the show today and find out what she's all about and stuff. I'd found her via the internet. I saw some clips of the YouTube videos that she does with horror hosting and, like, you know, tours of her shop and stuff and just silly things like that. And, yeah, I'm going to have her on today and find out what she's all about and stuff. She's really pretty, really sexy, and so... it's going to be pretty fucking awesome. So, yeah, here is my interview with Janet Decay.
This is Janet.
Hey, Janet, welcome to the show.
Oh, hey there. Oh, my goodness. I apologize. How you doing?
I'm good. What are you sorry for?
Well, Monkey Man isn't here with me today. He is caught up in some work, so he should be over in a little while. But he had a deadline he couldn't miss.
Oh, I didn't even know I was going to be talking to him. I just wanted to talk to you.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we normally when we do interviews for podcasts and things like that, we're a pair.
I can't do pair interviews. I don't have the attention span for overlapping dialogue.
We've done this many times, but anyways.
Well, it's such an honor. Thank you for taking the time today.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Yes. So did you love horror at an early age?
Yeah, really since I was a kid, you know, watching the classic Universal Monsters on TV.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Three Stooges and the Addams Family and the Munsters. And then, you know, as a teenager, getting to watch, you know, the slasher movies from the video store and getting to watch all the Phantasm series with my older cousins. So, yeah, it was just a thing that I loved. And my birthday is 2 days before Halloween, so I've always liked Halloween stuff.
Oh, your birthday was yesterday.
Yeah.
Happy birthday.
Well, thank you.
Yeah. Do you remember the first horror movie you ever saw?
First one I ever saw. That's tough. There were so many. I really don't recall, but like the classic Dracula, Frankenstein, like those really stuck in my head.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mine was The Shining when I was only a year old. It scared the shit out of me, I'll tell you.
Watching that as a small child would terrify you. That would probably scar you for life.
Yeah. But when I saw it again when I was like 7, it didn't have that impact anymore. And it's like one of my favorite horror movies. I love it.
That's awesome. Yeah, it's hard for me to pick like a favorite, but like if you're talking about like the real creepy, gross out movies, probably Texas Chainsaw Massacre 1 and 2.
I'd never thought the Texas Chainsaw Massacre was that scary. I always thought it was just cheesy and it was suggestive. You know what I mean?
It creeped me out. It's just something about it. You know, wearing someone else's skin, the whole like Ed Gein thing.
Yeah. Ed Gein, Hannibal Lecter thing later. Yeah.
Yeah.
That whole thing. I've interviewed a couple people from that movie, too.
Yeah, Gunnar Hansen, I've met him a few times back when he would attend Cinema Wasteland. He was a guest there, and they would have, like, Texas Chainsaw Massacre discussion panels. And he was really nice to the fans, but I'm trying to remember when he passed away. It wasn't that long ago.
2014.
Okay, yeah, so just 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my favorites, I love Friday the 13th, Dawn of the Dead, Reanimator, Mirror Mirror. This one movie Charlie Band did in the 80s that nobody really knows about called The Alchemist.
Yeah, that I haven't seen. I haven't seen Mirror Mirror. Reanimator I've seen. Mm-hmm. You know, of course, you know, Dawn of the Dead and, like, the Romero movies, many of those I've seen. But, yeah, these are classics. Like, something about them, they just, they did everything with style. It was, it just had a certain charm to it. And it's something that can appeal to many different age groups.
Yeah.
I love those a lot. But, like, just yesterday, we were watching American Horror Story Season 5. Oh, it's nasty, but it's cool.
Yeah. I mean, they had, because back in those days, they used film, not CGI.
Right. And I prefer the practical effects over CGI.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do, too. I just can't get into certain things. This past summer, I saw the HBO remake of Fahrenheit 451, and there's a scene where Lynn Griffin, she sets herself on fire, and just the effects were just so cheesy. Like, someone took, like, a paintbrush and was, like, you know, painting it on as it was going on. It was just, I couldn't describe it. It was bad.
Oh, geez, yeah, the original movie I was not a fan of, so this remake I'll have to give it a try, but the book was amazing on its own, and the movie's like, well, that first movie didn't do it justice in my opinion, but yeah, this yeah. new one I'll have to see.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of Martin Scorsese's favorite movies, but the remake has some really good acting in it. I do recommend it overall, just the effects are really cheesy, that's all. Have you ever had a crush on anybody in horror movies?
Probably Bela, because when he was younger, he was a handsome dude. Bela Lugosi was an awesome actor, started out as a stage actor, and was, you know, Eastern European, Hungarian, and just that accent. It was cool. So him and, let's see, who else? Probably Johnny Depp, but every girl likes Johnny Depp. That's pretty common.
Yeah. A big one for me was Linnea Quigley.
Oh, she's cute. And she's so nice, too.
Yeah.
Her again at Cinema Wasteland in Strongsville, Ohio. Her and Debbie Rochon, really nice lady.
Yeah, I've interviewed Linnea twice. She interviewed me for her documentary last year. And I was just in heaven. It was great. And Debbie Rochon, yeah, I'm supposed to interview her soon. She's flaked on me twice before, but hopefully next Sunday I'll actually get to interview her.
Cool. So what are your favorite movies from those lovely ladies?
Let's see. For Linnea, I love, let's see, Return of the Living Dead, Hollywood Chainsaw Hookers, Sorority Babes in the Slime Ball Bolorama, Witch Trap, oh God, let's see. Oh, Silent Night, Deadly Night, even though she's only in it for a scene. She has a really cool death in it, though. And of course, her workout video, that was a huge staple of my masturbation fantasies growing up.
I have that on VHS, and, I forgot to bring it with me today. I was going to put it in the shop. I have a little shop here in Lakewood, Ohio called the Thrift Crip, and we offer buy-sell trade for vintage, like VHS and records and collectible toys, things like that. So, yeah, I do get people that look for those old VHS.
Yeah, I need a new copy of that for her to sign eventually. I used to have one years ago. Let's see, Debbie Rochon. I love Santa Claus. You know, the John Russo movie, Santa Claus.
Yeah.
And,
the killer Santa. There's a lot of different holiday movies that are, they have a cheese appeal to them. They're cheesy, but they're fun to watch.
Oh, yeah. But do you remember New Year's Evil?
One.
Yeah.
I've heard good things about it.
I was talking to an actor from that yesterday. That was 1980. There was one back in the 70s. It was a Memorial Day slasher movie. Bob Clark made it just before he made Black Christmas.
Oh,
Yeah, I haven't seen it. I want to see it, though. Yeah, the Memorial Day one.
Well, since Halloween's tomorrow, and then we have Thanksgiving coming up, have you seen Thanksgiving?
I heard about it. Is it good?
It's good. It's an indie film, and I can't remember for the life of me who directed it, but it's really cheesy. The turkey is like a puppet,
Yeah.
and he goes around killing people.
Oh my God.
So it's all practical effects. Definitely no CG there, but and it's yeah, you definitely need to watch it.
I heard, I don't know if it's out yet, but there's a there's one coming out that Felissa Rose made where there's like a it's like a it's like an ugly sweater, ugly Christmas sweater that's like killing people who wear it. Yeah. I'm just like, that is so original. I wish I'd come up with it because I write horror movies. I wish I'd come up with that one.
Yeah, that's really clever, and it's right on topic since that's a popular thing now.
I want to do a horror movie where people are getting slaughtered on Sadie Hawkins Day.
Oh, yeah, that would be interesting. As far as I know, there's no movies about that.
Nobody has ever made a movie about Sadie Hawkins Day, as far as I know. But yeah, that's like a really clever idea, I think. When did you start going to conventions?
My first convention was actually 2003 for an anime convention called OhioCon, and they still have it every January in Columbus, Ohio. So I was also a fan of anime and cosplay, and around 2007 got involved in acting and modeling as a side hustle. There were indie film people around here in Cleveland, Ohio that wanted to put some things together, and they would ask, "Hey, do you want to be a zombie? Do you want to be a vampire? Do you want your head cut off in a movie?" I'm like, "Okay, let's give this a try." And they originally, in the old days of MySpace, I think we may have met, like I may have met some of these people from conventions where I would dress up in costume, and they liked my costumes. And some of the local photographers and filmmakers may have been friends, a lot of mingling, but.
Nice.
Yeah, it's been fun, and then after a little while, decided to put my own videos together with my co-host, Grim Gory, and we have a show called The Mummy and the Monkey, and that's on Facebook Live every Friday night where we play a cheesy old B movie. We put together our own comedy skits. We interview celebrities. We've even screened some independent movies.
Yeah, I love going to conventions. I started going 2 years ago. I was a late bloomer because when I was growing up, Fangoria's Weekend of Horrors was the only one that there was, and my parents never took me to it. And after I had my car accident 3 years ago that nearly killed me, I decided I was going to pursue show business, and I started going to conventions and just became hooked on them and stuff. And that's just my thing now. And it's just a lot of fun. I love going to them.
Wow, so 3 years ago you were almost killed in an accident.
Yes, I got hit by a car. It was a drunken misadventure with this douchebag that I was hanging out with. And I spent 30 days in a coma and 5 months in the hospital.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's like a real life horror story there. Sometimes the real life stuff is scary, or scarier than the movies.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. I still can't believe I got through it.
Awesome. You're with us now, and it sounds like you're doing much better.
Yep, it's getting there. It's doing really good. I started this podcast after I moved in with my mom because she needed help with the rent. And I'm a stand-up comedian, and there's no comedy clubs over here, so this is like my means of like communicating and being funny and stuff.
Oh, nice. So
Yeah.
we are, because you are out in California, for the San Francisco people who may be listening, we are on KOFY TV, Coffee TV in San Francisco, on Sunday, well, late Saturday night at 12:30 a.m. your time. We have a half-hour show. It's called The Mummy and the Monkey, and they show our celebrity interviews and skits, and then there's even some footage of us visiting haunted places in Ohio. But it's through the month of November, and if we get a long-term contract, that'll be cool too, but it's just a short-term thing to see how it goes.
Wow, because I know there's creature features on Coffee 20, and I mean, the show is okay, it's not great, but it replaced another horror show that was on before it that got taken off the air after like 8 years, only because they were being raunchy and inappropriate on the air in the last year that they were on, you know? Yeah, that's news to me. Wow, that's pretty cool, though, that you got that.
Yes, we'll be on after Creature Features, and after there's a clown show called Circus of Chaos, and it's like this clown guy that interviews people, and he has like people dressed in costumes and they do weird videos, but it's like an interesting mix, and for a while they were calling it like Scary Saturday Night. Mm-hmm. They started it earlier this month.
Wow, I did not know that. That's awesome. Before we get into the show, though, and everything, I wanted to ask you, do you think today's horror, in terms of originality, has become a little antiquated?
I'm not seeing a lot of originality in modern horror films. Usually it's like remakes or sequels. Like that Ouija movie came out, and now there's like 10 different Ouija board movies. Or they bring back Halloween again, you know? And I hear the Halloween movie's good. I haven't seen it yet, but it's like, can't we come up with a new monster? Can't we come up with something else? Like, they'll put out one kind of cool thing. Like, there was that movie Annabelle.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's, like, all these other, like, haunted doll things and, like, Ouija board movies. And I'm just seeing, like, a lot of the same, you know, and it's the same, you know, like, don't run up the stairs type of thing, you know, where people are doing all the things you're not supposed to do in a horror film, and they all get killed really easily. So I'd like to see something different, and there is one, and I think it's an indie flick. I saw it on Netflix a year or two ago called The Babadook.
Uh-huh. I heard of it, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like a kid's, like, not necessarily a kid's movie, but it has to do with ghost stories, you know, with this Babadook, like, demon ghost thing. And it's interesting because it was visually different, it had a different story and an all-new monster. So I was a big fan of that.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, you've been acting for a while and everything. But when did you become Janet Decay?
Janet Decay started in 20... Well, I was named her in 2012, but in 2010 there was a Lakewood Cherry zombie walk. And all my friends were going, and everyone's dressed like zombies, and I thought, well, what can I do a little bit different? So I created a mummy costume. Made it all myself, threw some bandages together, and went out there, and it was a lot of fun. And, then in 2012, I was helping a friend with their, like, movie review website. So I was like, okay, well, what can my pen name be?
Mm-hmm.
Kay, the movie reviewer, horror films, action films, whatever. So we had some differences, and we parted ways.
Mm-hmm.
And around 2013, a local film director here befriended a guy named Daniel Kristancic, who wanted to put together his own show called The Daughter of the Ghoul on cable TV in Cleveland.
Mm-hmm.
And we had horror movie hosts in Ohio, like Big Chuck and Little John, The Ghoul, Son of Ghoul, Big Chuck and Houlihan in the 70s, Ghoulardi in the 1960s. So there's a ton of horror hosts in Ohio. There's something in the water out here. And this guy was a fan of it and wanted to put together his own thing, and he wanted a female to host it. So I auditioned for the part, got the gig, and for a year or so, it was called The Daughter of the Ghoul, hosted by Janet Decay. And we would play public domain films, put together little comedy skits, we would go on location and get video. It was fun, but once that was canceled in 2014, James and I, which is now my co-host, Grimgory the Monkey Man, we decided to try to put our own videos together, you know, and keep doing our thing, and dip our toe in the water and learn video editing and behind the scenes stuff. And we actually met on the set of Daughter of the Ghoul because he would help with some of the artwork and graphics for it and make props for the show.
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't know what to name it, though. You know, because he had his monkey character, Grim Gory. He was like an ape-man guy. Mm-hmm. I had my mummy character, Janet Decay. And we went to a Halloween thing. It was, I think, late 2014, where it was like a trick-or-treat event. They were giving out candy to the kids. So we dressed up in character, passed out candy, and we got some video of the Halloween decorations. We thought it was fun. And the kids were yelling at us. They were going, "Mummy! Monkey!" So then later that day, I told James, I'm like, "That's the name of our show. We're the Mummy and the Monkey." And it just kind of stuck.
Wow. It's amazing. So so you shoot your shows independently?
Yeah, we pretty much, we write, we edit, we produce, we do the video, we make our own props, make our own costumes. Every now and then we'll have a friend help with the camera.
Mm-hmm.
Most of it is we're one mummy, one monkey army. And before then, I was, there was a movie out called Revenge of the Spacemen that now Troma owns and distributes. But I starred in that one, and that was shortly before we put together The Mummy and the Monkey.
Nice.
Anyone wants to look me up? I was in Revenge of the Spacemen, and it was like a comedy, like a tip of the hat to Invasion of the Saucer Men, and like those cheesy 50s sci-fi movies.
Mm-hmm. Do you only show public domain horror films?
No, it's public domain and independent films, as long as we get permission from the director. So we are open to showing indie films.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, even though I like bloody, disgusting movies too, for our show, we try to keep it for most ages. I think the goriest we've played so far was last Friday's episode. We played the movie Children Shouldn't Play with Dead Things from 1972.
Wow.
And it was a zombie film, you know, and people are getting eaten. But we thought it would be fun to play for a Halloween show.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah, I'm working pre-production, so to speak, on my own horror show. I want to do it out in the Bay Area. I might be moving back again in 2019. And, yeah, I want to get some friends together and we want to shoot it independently and stuff and, like, go to conventions and sell burnt copies of it or get one of the few remaining cable access stations in the Bay Area to put it on. I was talking to this horror host in Boston, Penny Dreadful the 13th.
Yeah, Penny Dreadful. I like her. She's sweet.
Yeah, she's really sweet. And, you know, she did something amazing because all the horror hosts that I've interviewed for the most part, they've all been hired guns who, like, came in after someone else had previously hosted for a UHF station network. But she, you know, created her own show and put it on cable access in Boston, and it spread to 200 cities, like, within a year. And that's just amazing. You know, I don't know anybody else who's ever done that. And it's really, like, inspired me to do my show like that.
That's really cool. But what I'm seeing is we would send in things to the public access table. We would send things to different Roku channels and YouTube. But the most feedback I've seen and the most viewership I've seen is from this live stream that we started doing this year. Mm-hmm. It's pretty much like the gamer geek YouTube, Twitch. We made a Twitch account, and Amazon recently bought Twitch, so that might be the next YouTube. We haven't done anything with the channel yet, but we were thinking of going live on there from time to time.
What's it called?
We're the Mummy and the Monkey on Twitch. Twitch.tv.
Twitch is like YouTube?
Yeah, it's like a YouTube, and there's gamers that will go live and show their, like, videos on there. There's even artists that will go on there and draw pictures or paint live. So
wow.
There's people that have, like, politics shows on there. So it's not just for gamers, but it's very gamer-centric, because that's how it started out.
Wow, you know what? We should do, like,
a Facebook Live. I should do that with my show. Go Facebook Live. You know, I mean, I was definitely thinking about putting it on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram because I have a friend. He's a horror host in the Bay Area, and he put episodes of his show on YouTube, and his channel got deleted, even though the movies were not copyright. They were public domain.
Yeah, with YouTube, we're getting that too. Even the public domain films, even our own content, has gotten some copyright things. So we do upload some behind the scenes videos and a few skits from time to time, but we can't go live and really show a movie on there. We can go live and just talk. You know, if you want to talk about movies, you can. There's a lot of movie reviewers that are on YouTube that get a ton of views. You just can't, like, play a movie, even if it is public domain. It has to do with their algorithms, where it's real glitchy. Even one that's public domain or one that doesn't have a copyright on it, there'll be someone overseas that'll say, oh, I own 30 seconds of a song from the background music, and then they'll take it down or try to monetize off of what you uploaded.
Yeah. I don't get that at all, you know. I think if the person's getting, you know, 1,000, 100,000, million views, then they'll leave them alone. But if they're, like, not getting that many views, then they start fucking with them. That's just my opinion. You know.
Yeah, it's not necessarily that. It has to do with their algorithm. And anyone can say, hey, I own that, when they may not own it. An example is, I have permission to use the song Graveyard Rock by a horror hostess in the 50s, Tarantula Ghoul. Her son said I could use her song. She's passed away, you know, but they gave me permission to use her original music. And I used it for one of our YouTube videos, and it got a copyright thing. A record store from California claimed to own it.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to file a dispute with him, and then he dropped it after a while. But yeah,
wow.
Anyone can just say, oh, hey, I own that, when they may not really own it.
Yeah.
So it just gets aggravating.
Yeah, and the worst part about it is they don't ask for proof if they own it.
Not always, no. And it's all, like, automated.
Yeah, it's just really, really strange. How come you're in Ohio and not in California?
Because the rent is cheap in Ohio. I couldn't afford California. Everything's expensive out there. And I was born in Ohio, so I do love the Midwest. I would definitely love to visit California. And it would be cool to live out that way and not have snow. But yeah, right now I am Midwest bound.
Nice. I've never been to Ohio. I mean, the only states I've been to, I lived in Arizona briefly back in 2007. That was a disaster. It's too hot down there. And my dad lives in Marysville, Washington. I visit him occasionally, and I've been lucky to be there when it's not raining.
And I apologize. I do have customers in the store, so I may have to cut, you know, how are we doing on time?
Oh, I just have a couple quick questions, and then we're done.
Okay.
So what are you dressing up as for Halloween?
maybe just a normal person. I don't know. We've been so busy this month as with the Mummy and the Monkey. Maybe I'll dress as something else tomorrow. We're going to have a low-key Halloween and hang out with the neighbors and pass out candy.
Yeah. I had not planned on dressing up. I decided after I was doing a Halloween podcast with my friend last night late, and then I was like, okay, I'll come up with something. I think I'll just wear a belly shirt and go as a belly button fetishist.
There you go.
Which leads me to my creepy question that I like to ask all horror hosts. You can answer this in your alter ego of Janet Decay. Janet, what does your belly button smell like?
Like tanner leaves, like from the Mummy movie.
Tanner leaves, like,
you know.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe like honey and tanner leaves. Yep.
Mine smells like a pterodactyl's toe jam.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
That's always my answer. Always. Do you have any horror show episodes that are going to air on Halloween?
We are going to play a retro Halloween Hootenanny show that Grim Gory put together about 5 years ago. So we will be showing that on Facebook Live, and our Facebook page is The Mummy and the Monkey. And every Friday night at 10 o'clock Eastern Time, we do host, and it's a live interactive horror-hosted show. Mm-hmm. We do archive it, where you could go back later and watch. And we do upload videos to YouTube, so we are The Mummy and the Monkey on YouTube.
Nice. And any upcoming convention appearances or acting projects you want to plug?
We are working on a comic book and a movie ourselves, and then Dark Xmas, November 17th and 18th in Hudson, Ohio. We will be there both days.
Awesome. Well, Janet, I appreciate your time. Thank you so much. I hope you continue further success. I hope to meet you in person one day. Happy Halloween, happy holidays, and have a great day.
You too. Thank you. Happy Halloween, guys.
Yep. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Well, there you have it, Janet Decay. Ain't she a sweetheart? Thank you so much, Janet. You're pretty cool, and I wish you further success. And that's pretty cool that your show is going to be on Coffee 20 in the Bay Area. I hope they pick you guys up. If you like this video, everyone, please subscribe to my YouTube channel. Add me as a friend on Facebook. Join my Tommy Kovac Comedian page on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram and all that fun stuff. Well, that's all time we have this week on Splat from the Past. Until next time, this is Tommy Throwback Kovac saying, there's no shame in living in the past because the present sucks. Later, dudes.